maybe the most, one of the most successful artistic directors of New York. Came up out of stage then. He's in the lobby, he's before every show, and at every intermission. Big guy, loud sweater, his audience knows who he is, and they can always find him. And they can always tell him whatever they thought. And his subscribers trust him, and he trusts them, and will always lend an ear. And it's meant that even when they don't like a particular show, they can sound off to him about it. And, you know, and think, all right, well, maybe down the line I'll have some sort of impact. I'm not being ignored. This is even voiced about.
Right.
But he also quite consciously, you know, tries to stay part of a larger national competition for years. So he's not only just trying to, you know, be in feedback loop with his subscribers. And so he does challenge them. That's part of what I'm trust about. But then, you know, it's not going up to the weekend because they know where he lives. And they'll find him and let him know. Yep. It's been a very fruitful conversation.
Yep. So the interesting thing that I sort of took from this aspect of the conversation was, from the NARS perspective, you want to generate as much feedback as you can get. And then you need to have some methodology of weighting those voices.
Yes.
And certainly, print journalism in the past has been a big way, a big weighting factor. And then there's this other aspect of like, well, trust. You find people you personally have a relationship with, they trust to give you feedback. But I think that's sort of like the question. How do you generate voices, and then how do you weight those voices? And there, I mean, my inclination is usually to go online, and I think it sort of interacts with a lot of what people are doing online, with like people are both blogging and tweeting, and filling out forms for Gold Star, but then there's a question of reputation and how you weight those voices. So, Mark.
It makes me wonder about audiences, and I also, I sometimes wonder if we trust our audiences. That we want to do the work for them, but we don't trust them enough to say, you need to rewrite the play. Like if that's like I think we structure, we oftentimes will structure these things on our terms, on artist terms, and not the audience terms. And we're asking them to meet us where we are, and I don't know, that's, you know, where can we meet them where they are? And it made me think a lot about what Dan was saying about somebody feeling like, I'm not an expert, so I can't weigh in on this, but it's, I trust you to pay your $20 to see it. So, for now, let me continue here.
Same group, kind of like a class. You get to meet each other and work.
Just a tiny
thought, not knowing a lot about it, but it's not, it's sort of a class, but isn't it actually sort of a group of donors?
Well,
no,
I don't think it's a donor.
They pay to be a part of that, and part of that is because the program has gotten such, has gotten so popular now, but I think it began when Ed started it really as a way to get their board to have a greater understanding of the process.
New work.
Right.
Did some interesting too. I actually went last year, not to all of them, to one of the sessions. They actually have, people do pay, but they also have free admission for students, which is an interesting way of cultivating
audience,
generation audience groups. And they take people through 3-4 productions, so there's continuity about developing language about which to talk about theater. It's an interesting program.
And the audience and the participants have to commit to going through all of those, that they won't be accepted into the program, if you will, unless they're actually willing to have time.
Yes?
I think the one other very important thing with feedback we can hear from this gentleman here and then other people who've spoken is a question of whether you really want to hear what people have to say. And I think one other element that we haven't discussed is respect. And I think that that's a fundamental part of trust. And so on the one hand, when you're having feedback sessions, talkback sessions where it was discussed in the last breakout session that we're actually doing it for the audience more than we really are doing it to learn about the play for ourselves. It's a difficult thing. You've also explained you're doing it in one town, so then how do you handle talkbacks in others, So it's a very difficult thing. I think we have to be much clearer in our own minds when not just, paying lip service to asking for feedback.
I have to say, in my experience, that the reasons for talkbacks are not what they seem. So much of theater's talkbacks have to do with audience development and even subscribers. Let's face it, that's why a lot of talkbacks happen. We want you to be more involved with our theater because we want you to buy more single tickets, because we want you to subscribe. It's not about pure engagement or other things.
So when you take it beyond the talkback then, do you think that's also true for the work itself? Because we've been focusing a lot on talkbacks, but there's that conversation separate from the talkback situation, just what's
it? You mean program
engagement?
Well, my experience, not so much. My experience programming has more to do with what's great work that we want to produce that we think our audiences will be engaged with. So I think it's a little different. But I think at its core, audience talkbacks, not everywhere, but in my experience, have to do with the ultimate goal of staying in business, perpetuating the institution, of getting more subscribers. And I think where that exists, we have to face it. It may not be the universal case, but it's hard in those circumstances to be honest about the work. And somebody mentioned a 25-minute session. That's another clear, we don't want too much engagement if we've got 25 minutes.
Right.
Didn't mean to bring everybody down. We just have to get out there. Why do we do talk back to the first
that was just one example.
But I think we need to be honest with the audience about what the purpose of it is, and then they'll be happy. Well, maybe they'll be happy to go with this. But I mean, true. I mean, I'm a playwright myself, so there are times when it is really useful for me to know what they're thinking about, particularly if it's facilitated well. And then there's times when really the play now is done. I'm glad to hear what you thought, but I'm no longer really working on it. So it would be unfair for the theater then to say, well, it's really important for the playwright to hear what you have to say because he's go back and make all these. Right. No, I'm not. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So then it's about something else. They can have a conversation about the play and about their experience of the play, which is about deepening their own experience than about changing the work. So I think if we're clear about, and then that is perfectly fine, because the deeper relationship with the work will in fact lead to people coming back and buying the tickets. And that's not a bad thing, it's a good thing.
But also, I think the example that Michael gave of the way my group is using that audience feedback session sounds like a terrific way to engage an audience and grow and grow.
Right. And they're doing it at a point when the work needs the feedback. He's not doing it midway through the run.
My point is, can't the audience talkback session be seen? I mean, can't provoking an open and frank discussion about the quality of the work, even if it's not being used to develop that work in particular, be used to develop the audience? And the audience's engagement with the art company.
Yes.
Someone who had a hand.
And with your
hand.
With the artist present. Either way.
I think either way. I think definitely with members of the artistic staff present. It doesn't have to be the playwright.
Right.
I mean, the artist is also the actor, the performer, is the director, is the set designer. It can be a whole lot of different ways, but I think from what I'm hearing, I can see that as a very useful tool and a way of taking the act of criticism into a whole different forum where it can be used as to support the art.
Well, I think James' point about what's the purpose of the talk back is really good. Is it about simple audience engagement? I was just going to bring up an example of how we structured the alternate theater, a talk back, that was specifically about pursuing excellence through the means of audience engagement and audience feedback. And, you know, when we do these things, it's very specific to the project as opposed to a cookie cutter, this is how we do a talk back. I personally really hate talk backs. But what we did was we had an inserted program in the survey. And at the end of the show, everybody kind of sits there stunned. And so, you know, I come out and say, okay, everybody, here's your pens, everybody fill this out. And then we give everybody wine while they're filling out their surveys. And nobody left. Nobody walked out without filling out a survey. And then Bob Ernst comes down, and one by one, people will come and they rush and they hand in their survey so that they can go have a one-on-one discussion with Bob. And what questions were on that survey were specifically geared towards what Bob needed to take this project to the next level of excellence.
Yes.
The buzzword of the day. And you know, and we were kind of nervous about what our subscribers' reaction would be to this piece because it was very non-linear, very non-traditional. And some people loved it, of course. And the people who didn't, or they loved it when they thought about it for a week. They would write into us, because we also gave them an email way to give feedback as well after the immediate feedback. And they said, you know, thank you for challenging me by doing this piece. And I think that is just an amazing piece of feedback to get from your audience, and to get it repeatedly, again and again and again, from your core base of subscribers. But I think that the real key question to a talk back is, what is the role that it plays in your process? Is it about developing the work? Is it about engaging with your audience so they'll give you money? Is it about something that the artist needs? What's it about?
Well, not only that, but just kind of the type of feedback you're getting, because, like, you know, in psychology experiments, what will happen sometimes, the researchers will look for the results they want. So if you're as a theater company, you're looking at to what the audience is saying, you're like, oh, you got a little confused by it. I like what you're saying, rather than maybe 90% of people said they really liked it or said they really hated it, but you get to that 5% of people who said they were confused. It's like, how do you take all of the different things that you're getting and incorporate it back into the production that you're doing? Kind of like along the lines of what you're saying.
Michael?
Well, it's just another thing that on the road. We'll do conversations with the audience, and suddenly we're in Cleveland. And it's not like we're going to rewrite the show before we get to Detroit or something. But what we do is invite members of the community who are involved with the issue that we're doing the show about, so that it's a panel discussion about the show and about, but about the issue, because we're trying to protect the audience. And sometimes it can feel a little like it's all about us. You know, when you're doing it, it's just thank you for talking about us. for 45 minutes. Goodbye, Cleveland. You know. Yeah. So you really need to look, you really show here's a farmer, here's a scientist, and here's all these people, so we can talk about the issues that are in the show. Because it's like, it goes back to what is the point of talking. Sometimes it's early in production, it is to affect the show. Sometimes it is just for subscription theaters and stuff like that to grow audience. But if you're trying to make the audience change as people, you know, using the talk back to expand the conversation past the show, they can go, okay, now let's all go out over to capitalism, kind of. George is in the lobby, you know, by you know, just really being able to structure, go, what is it exactly we're trying to do? And, you know, what is the effect we want to have?
But I think, I don't know, it feels like the tougher question is, who are you going to listen to mm-hmm. give you copious notes about the work? Who are you going to listen to say, well, you've been doing this for 5 years, it hasn't changed, it has to evolve, it has to grow? Who's going to give you that? That seems a harder question than the audience. Because the audience, you can always let yourself off the hook.
And that's a little bit of where I was going to with that earlier really question about, if you surround yourself with people who get you, are you going to get to them? Maybe you will, and maybe you won't. I don't know.
You know, when I go to Ashton and I see shows there, it's going to be very careful, because they have an audience that has got a particular taste. And when you're developing shows for that audience, you're going to do their reaction. Then you leave and you develop it, and you're like, oh my God, this, you know, it's, sometimes you develop an audience, not a good thing. So, I think the other question is, how do you make that conversation, that tougher conversation about who you're going to listen to?
Yeah. Yes.
I've been doing a show called Talking Angels, Budapest 1943. It's about the Holocaust encounter. It's a true story. People wrote down what we call an experience of transcendence. I've been doing it for 10 years, and to promote it, audience feedback over a span of 10 years. And the relationship is my passion that started to do this thing. And as I said, this to other my colleagues, people who are on the other side. But to attempt in my lifetime to do something, it was excellent. I just committed to one play. That I said, what did they do 100 years ago? People would do Juliet till they were 60. Eleanor and Duse did Juliet at 60, because that's what she was known for. And I just thought, well, that was what I wanted to feel that in my own way. I wanted to attempt that. And the audience feedback, if you are curious, over 10 years, is always, they have questions about the situation. They have questions about why do they focus, how could they focus for 17 months on these voices that they didn't have before channeling at the time. And they go right to the core of why I did the thing. And so it doesn't matter what anyone says, although if you come, I don't care. But you gave me a good review once. But I had an orgasm on the stage. Yeah, Dario Fogli. So that is the catharsis for me, you know, is I did the thing with a certain intent, and the people that, you know, over the years gave me the feedback with that intent, I'll do it another 10 years. And it frees me from the kind of guesswork that I kind of hear in the room, or what the direction the audience wants. I think if you're doing something that's like coming from that vibrational place, and the audience, people just look at you, that's it.
For me, audiences that are looking for a partner, and all kinds of things don't happen. You know what I mean? And I'm not necessarily asking them to tell me about the show. But when I'm on tour, I have talkbacks because it's a way to get them to talk to me more. They just saw me on stage. I was just up in Alaska for like 2.5 days, performing up there. And the people just loved it, that, oh, now we can talk to you. And then it's like, my job is to be interesting, because then they'll go tell people, like, oh, there she is. That's the one right over there. So it is the audience. I agree that what Robert was saying about it works both ways. Because I think that if you need feedback from people, that can be there too, lead from the audience. But see, the audience is that other community, the other part of the community that I feel like is very, very important, regardless of what they give. And I think people just appreciate, a lot of people just appreciate things. Like, oh, we have a talk back, we just want to like, you know, talk with you a little bit after the show. People love that. I just, in my work, I think they love that. Then I find also I attract layers of different communities, and people that never go to the theater, you know. And all of a sudden there's Odessa Jones doing whatever I do. And they're like, wow, oh my gosh, go ahead, sister. And they don't see theater, you know what I'm saying? And I realize they're there with my theater goers who have been with me all my life. And I think that they're particularly included. I just feel like they are the other community part. However you want to cut it, that they should be treated with respect and that kind of regard. Because they can leave a film, you know, if they want to shop anyway, you know? And I always tell them, look, if you like the show, tell your friends. If you didn't like the show, mind your own business. They love that too. You know, so it's, yeah, but I think they're another community part.
I'm thinking about what you were saying about like how do you figure out which voices to listen to. I mean, as a company, I think that's hard, but I think what it comes down to is really personally as an artist, as a playwright, you have to figure out, well, who do you care most about?
Yeah.
Are you fine just finding that Aspen audience and just talking to them? Are you fine just talking to the print media and getting your things reviewed really, really well? And I think that really comes down to the core of the artist, and that's how they have to figure out like, which voices are they going to listen to. They have to figure out what they want, or what they want as artists.
And I wonder if anybody in the room, we at Theater Bay Area, we started thinking about this about a year ago, and we started hearing from some folks, and I can't remember any names, which is probably good, some artistic directors who typically will wait until the show closes, as someone was saying to do, Paul, I think, and then pull together kind of a cabinet that they have, like maybe six people, to meet with them together, in person, to tell them about the production.
As a group or one-on-one?
As a group. But I'm just wondering if there are others who have sort of a practice, anybody in the room or maybe that you've heard of, that might get us to where what you're talking about.
Well, I don't know if this answers that directly, but it seems to me that whether the conversation is with audience, fellow artists, with our staffs, if we're part of the institution, that if we're going to better the conversation about excellence, we also have to be willing to talk about failure. And that's because otherwise, I was really struck by what Paul said earlier. You know, I don't want to engage in any conversation if I'm not going to learn something. And I think as an industry and as Americans, we're often very unwilling to talk about that we actually, you know, yes, I made a mistake when I decided this choice. And that making a mistake is not, you know, it's not going to stop the world from working. Actually, it's the step to getting to a greater level of excellence. So wherever we have these conversations, I think that's a key component.
You remind me of a book I read, which is amazing, called Art and Fear, written by two painters. And it's applicable to any artist, I think, but it's especially writers. In one of the theories of the authors who are two painters is that the work of art takes place not in the product, but in the leap from one project to another. Which does speak, and I have so often longed to debrief after a play with some or all of the artists or participants. But usually we're so busy running to the next project that I haven't gotten to do it.
There's actually a new book out now that's about specifically about learning from failure. One of the examples they gave is Twilight Dawn working on Yugen out, and that in Chicago it was an absolute disaster. But her ability to take in constructive criticism from those trusted advisors, namely Jennifer Tipton, on that one, was what allowed her to go so in between projects to that next level of excellence and actually turn it around, but only by learning from that shifter.
Lisa, and then you.
Me?
Yeah.
Part of what we do when I produce new work is
or we had a post-mortem with the team, essentially about what we did, how we can do it better next time. But we think, especially with New York, it's really important because there is no cookie-cutter process. Each project is a new path, and how you can support that project. As a producer, it's putting the right team together. Not, you know, one designer might not be right for this project, but it's creating that team, which hopefully will create the magic, ultimately, and excel in what we're trying to do. And if we fail, probably at least 50%, if not more, of the time, or probably 70% of the time. But that's also part of it. And being okay to say, we're going to reach far, we're going to go as far as we can, and we might fail, and not be fearful of it. Because the next time, hopefully, will be better. We learn from that and we move on.
There's that adage, if you hit the target every time, you're standing too close.
Yeah, yes.
Well, I won't take too much more time because this is following on what you just said, Lisa. I'm producing director at Here Art Center in New York, and we develop work over a long period of time with a whole core group of resident artists who sort of work for 2-3 years on the project. And what we try to do is create an atmosphere of peer exchange and feedback all through the course of the development of the project. But we invite the audience in during the process. So for every reading, for every work in progress, there's a core group of peer artists who are coming, and we utilize the Liz Lerman feedback method, which we've started to expand to the larger audience, which is a very structured way of giving feedback. And then what we try to do is instruct the artists to, all along the way, develop the project, to invite the audience in. So before, during, and after the project is actually on stage, they've each got web pages that are dedicated to the project that are living on our website. So there's live blogging, there's Facebooking, there's Twittering, so there's technology aspect to it. And then during the run of the show, we're inviting conversations, and we do something called Cocktails in Context, where before the show, Kristen and I will sit and talk with audience members who are just talking about context about this work before they see the show. And then we'll do talkbacks where there really is more like what you were talking about, where we invite panelists in who have some expertise. Like one of the most successful talkbacks we've had was about a show that has a very deep kind of psychological underpinnings. It was a music theater piece, but we brought in psychologists and some people who worked with abuse, victims, etc. And it was a very deep and concentrated conversation. It was really about the issues, but it also brought out references to the work itself. And then lastly, it's like after they leave the theater, we send them a survey, and we want them to respond to both their experience at the theater and to the piece itself. So it's a lot of work. There's just no question, but it is this kind of trying to train both the artists and the audience, and your audiences as they're building in over 2-3 years, to just engage, find their community, and engage with that community all along the way. Just a few ideas.
We're out of time. Yeah, we're out of time.
A 15-minute break. Thank you all very much.